So, okay, to bring it back to the magic pill, I'm kind of interested. So let's say someone like me that my diet is mostly, I eat a lot of plants, a lot of greens, broad spectrum, carrots, tomatoes, I eat a lot of vegetables. So I get a ton of fiber. I eat a lot of fish. And I do eat like beans, so I'm not averse to legumes or even to oats. I like fiber. Let's say I wanted to, I'm like super interested in beta hydroxybutyrate because I've been following a lot of the research from Eric's lab, and I want to, you know, get some of those benefits. I want to increase my FOXO3. I want to reduce my lipid peroxidation. I want some of that signaling effect. Plus, I want beta hydroxybutyrate to be around to get into the brain, things like that. Can I potentially take a beta hydroxybutyrate, whatever delivery source, you know, powder, pill, whatever it is, and potentially achieve some of those same benefits that you would get from, you said, nutritional ketosis or ketosis from fasting? Let's say, but I don't eat a lot of, I don't eat refined carbs, so I'm not getting a huge insulin spike for the most part. So, do you know?
So, you want to have your cake and eat it, but you don't eat.
But cake, I don't eat cake. No, I just eat fiber. I
eat your fiber. You want to have your carbs and that's, you know, that's really what we're working on right now, and understanding in a head-to-head comparison to see if we can derive the same kind of benefits from ketone supplementation as we can with a ketogenic diet. We know the first kind of convincing study of this that we did was with CNS oxygen toxicity in our rat model. And in that case, the rats were eating a high carbohydrate standard rodent chow model. And we administered via, you know, an oral route, a ketone supplement in the form of a ketone ester. That's probably one of the more powerful forms of exogenous ketones that, we've developed. And that had the ability to prevent CNS oxygen toxicity from happening for almost over 500% delay in that time to CNS oxygen toxicity. And that could not be achieved, you know, with fasting. It could not be achieved with anti-seizure drugs. So when it comes to enhancing and preserving brain energy metabolism in the face of a tremendous oxidative stress that breaks down brain energy metabolism, we're able to enhance that and preserve that. So we've also studied in our animal model of cancer, metastatic cancer, simply giving ketones to the animals on a high carbohydrate diet. It was almost, you know, unexpected the level of enhanced survival that we had with ketone supplementation. This is a model of metastatic cancer, and the primary tumor was, it was derived from a glioblastoma, a GBM. And that tumor cell line is so aggressive that when it's injected or implanted into the flank of the animal, there's rapid systemic metastasis to all the organs and the brain. And it's a model that was developed by Professor Tom Seyfried at Boston College. And
didn't he publish a paper on
it? Made the cover of the International Journal of Cancer. When I wanted to do the study initially, I wanted to do a brain tumor model, like with our diet and our stuff. And he sort of wouldn't let me use the model. He's like, well, use this model of metastatic cancer because it's the most aggressive thing out there, and no one will, he's like, if you create a cure, something that can cure this animal of metastatic cancer, you basically stumbled upon something that has the potential to cure cancer. So that kind of intrigued me. So I knew working with this model would be kind of difficult because the tumor burden, the animals died so quick from the tumor burden. But it allowed us to screen a variety of things, and just using this model, understanding that in aggressive metastatic cancer, the cells are highly glycolytic, and they're highly in favor of using glucose and glutamine probably as an energy source. We have not, or looking at ways to target glutamine, but have not really kind of implemented that yet in a combination therapy. But regardless, the animals are eating a high carbohydrate diet with ketone supplementation, and it reduced tumor growth and proliferation. We think that the ketones may be altering glucose metabolism. Well, we We think so. There's more like sort of apoptosis in the tumors that were there, but just overall, there's just less tumor growth and less tumor burden, and enhanced, most importantly, a 50 to 60% increase in survival time in animals that are supplemented with this. And it wasn't, although the animals tend to eat a little bit less if they're in ketosis naturally, which makes a ketone supplement kind of an attractive thing for people that are dieting, because when you're sending energy to the brain in the form of ketones, it has sort of a satiating effect on your body, and it kind of shuts off that hypoglycemic trigger that makes you want to binge or crave food.
So is it changing ghrelin and leptin signaling?
We think so. Yeah, we think so. Or that's the next thing to look at. It does impact the satiety centers of the brain. It's not like you don't want to eat, but you have control over your appetite.
You know what? I just thought of lauric acid, which is C12, suppresses ghrelin in the gut, which is a hunger hormone.
Yeah.
So you might want to look into that. Yeah. That's kind of interesting, right?
Is that specific for lauric acid?
It's specific.
I knew it's certain fats. Really? Lauric acid?
Yeah, yeah.
That's interesting.
It is.
I'll look that up.
Sorry to interrupt, but anyways.
No, no.
Okay,
that's
so let's continue, because this is really cool. So,
yeah.
So you fed them a normal carbohydrate diet, gave them this ketone ester.
The same ketone ester,
the
which
tumor
is.
Tumor burden was decreased, survival time.
Yeah, survival time increased. Yep. And so that was, you know, another demonstration, and the data looked very similar to the ketogenic diet. So we did this study.
They were eating less, you said, right?
They were eating slightly less. So we went back. We were thinking, well, maybe we're just getting a calorie restriction effect. Because if you have a mouse model or any kind of cancer model and you overfeed it, you know, the tumors are going to go faster. And if you underfeed it, you know, you're going to restrict some of the tumor growth. So they were eating a little bit less, but maybe only 10% drop in body weight. So we went back and we did a calorie restriction control experiment. And although there was a decrease in tumor, it was nothing like the ketone supplement. So ketones, you know, we know undoubtedly they have anti-cancer effects. And it could be maybe through their expression of their gene expression, you know, as a histone deacetylase inhibitor. We think that they inhibit glycolysis. We think that they influence a number of, you know, pathways associated with cancer growth.
Did you measure mitochondrial respiration?
Of the tumor and the tissue, or
just or any tissue? Like, so let's say giving them ketones.
ROS production. Yeah, it can sort of knock down reactive oxygen
in the
species
tumor or in
production. In normal tissue, and now it's kind of interesting too that in the tumor tissue in previous experiments, I showed that it could knock it down significantly. But I think in the paper that we published, there was a slight decrease, in ROS production.
Yeah, that's interesting.
We don't know. Our experiments are sort of like a top-down approach. We find out what works, and then we're mechanistically going after it, and we're doing omics work, you know, metabolomics in particular, and Western blots and assays. And so now we're going after the mechanism. And if we understand the mechanism, we can kind of work backwards and tweak the molecule or adjust the diet in ways that may enhance the therapeutic effect.
It would be really interesting to do some of, I don't know if you can, you know, radio label these ketone esters and see,
that's
like, are they being used as a carbon source for ATP? Are they being used for else, right? Like
tracer studies. That's what we want to do. We're going to partner with a company that has sort of the market on doing these tracer fate associations. So they, you know, several, I think even doing a 13 carbon glucose tracer fate association study where we give this and we give ketones, you know, we look at the fate of glucose in the presence and absence of ketones and see how that may be influencing.
There you go. Is it going to the pentose phosphate?
Yes.
This is all stuff I really want to know, so I'm like super excited someone's going to be doing it.